And we'd also like to explore a bit how cooperative international trade policy measures, as well as private initiatives, could address some of these challenges. I'm joined for this discussion by an outstanding panel of experts. We have structured the discussion to begin with issues at the global level and then to move into a particular focus on East Africa and the Kenyan perspective. The biographies of all of the speakers are online on the Trade and Development Symposium website, so I'll introduce them here only briefly and then give them the floor. I'll start to my left. Usuf Rashid Sumaila is a professor at the University of British Columbia in Canada and director of the Fisheries Economics Research Unit and the Ocean Canada Research Partnership. And we'll be asking him to give us a bit of a sense of the scope and scale of IUU fishing and how trade in illegal fish catch affects sustainable development priorities. On my right, I have Juan Carlos Vasquez, who is the Chief of Legal Affairs and Trade Policy at CITES, that's the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species, and he'll be talking a bit about the way that CITES addresses illegal trade, but also how regional trade agreements have started to address the problem, which is, from an ICTSD trade policy perspective, extremely interesting. On my extreme right, we have Philip Moruti, who is Vice President for Species Protection at the African Wildlife Foundation, and he'll be talking to us a little bit about how illegal wildlife trade impacts on sustainable livelihoods, particularly in the African context. On my extreme left, we have Mohammed Alam, who is the Chief Executive of the World Wildlife Fund at WWF in Kenya, and we'll be asking him to talk about illegal trade, but specifically about the governance issues that come up in the context of illegal trade, particularly in the African context. And also on my right, we're very pleased to be joined by Paul Gathiju Masela, who is the spokesperson and head of communications at the Kenyan Wildlife Service, who will give us, essentially, sort of to round off the presentations, the government perspective on the real challenge of enforcement around illegal trade in natural resources and specifically in wildlife. So with those very brief introductions, I will give the floor first to Rashid to provide a bit of a, sort of from a global perspective, to talk a little bit about illegal fishing and the role that trade in illegal fish products can have in sustainable development and the challenges that presents. Rashid, the floor is yours.
So thank you very much, Alice, and thank you, those of you who made it here, thank you very much. I know there's a lot of competition for your time, and the opportunity cost of your time is very high, so thanks for coming. You know, I've been in symposiums and conferences where you have a room like this where it is not filled up. What usually happens is that you end up with a very interesting discussion, because these are the people who are really keen about it, so I hope to see the same here. Yeah, so let me start off. All right, so this is the title of my talk. So essentially, this is going to be about what we build about fisheries around the world.
And this picture we put together in an earlier study where we looked at collecting information about incidences of illegal fishing and boats that have been caught fishing illegally around the world. And you see, this is what we put together here. So this is happening almost everywhere in the world. And there are some hot spots and there are some, essentially, the reason for this is, as if you ask an economist, the reason we have this thing happening all over the place is that it is economically beneficial for people to do this. When there's money to be made, people will do it. And the reason they make money, you can think of it in just two ways. Number one, the authorities are not out there checking to make sure that they catch you when you fish illegally. So the detection rate is really low in many places, in Africa in particular, and around the world. The second thing is that even when you are caught, usually the penalty is very low or zero. So catching you is not enough. There has to be a penalty, because that is the combination of the two is what will take down your potential benefit, your expected benefits. And if we're able to do that, we'll take down a lot of what is happening in terms of illegal fishing. In fact, in this paper, we calculated that for us to balance the cost and the benefit, we will need to increase the current rate of penalty by up to 24 times, you know, around the world. So the economics favors this. That's point number one. Now, I said I will focus on. I just picked one example, and this is really hot stuff. It's actually not published yet, so this really, we are working on this now. This is our estimate of the amount of illegal fishing taking place in Guinea's waters. So you have Guinea there, and you have the exclusive economic zones shown in the almost rectangle there. That is the part of the ocean that the global community has allocated to Guinea as their exclusive economic zones. It's usually 200 nautical miles away from your coast. So Guinea owns these waters, globally agreed. And looking at that area, we estimated the amount of illegal fishing that is taking place. And you can see the countries that are doing it. China is big in this, and other countries, Korea, Guinea itself, you know, because people are not conforming to Guinean laws. They are Guineans, but they are not form, and they are also part of it. So there is a lot of illegal fishing taking place there. And this obviously has consequences economically and socially. In fact, it's estimated that globally, about $23 billion worth of fish is taken away illegally. So that is stealing the world's fish, up to $23 billion. And for Africa alone, we are talking about $1 billion of fish value, just the value, right? Catch times the price, $1 billion. Now, if you think of all the added value, we are talking about $3 billion a year that goes according to estimates. And I can almost assure you that these estimates are underestimates, because it's only those that are apprehended that we have in and many goes on. So this has huge consequences in terms of jobs, in terms of economy, and in terms of development. And we need to do something about that. Now, the next graph actually summarizes this. And if you look at Guinea, officially, that's the official reported catch according to FAO. And if you take our estimate of illegal catches, unreported catches, that is what you see on top there. And you can see that it's actually increasing. So this is not reducing, which again is a problem. If you start high and you are working yourself down, then it's a good thing you are reducing. But we see that it's increasing. And you can see the proportions in terms of what is official and what is not. And again, this goes into a lot of economic impacts all through. And another thing about illegal fishing is if it is taking place and there's no consequence, it has a tendency to corrupt those who are not cheating at this point in time. Because you see your counterparts cheating and getting away with it, making money. I mean, you sit down and you think and say, what the hell am I doing? Maybe I should do the same. So you end up dragging more and more people into this business, which is not a good thing. Okay, so here, what I'm going to show you here is there's one part of the world where we have seen declines in the illegal catch, and this is the Kamla area in the Southern Ocean for the fish they catch there. It used to be a big problem, huge, and they managed to take it down. And what I will do in my remaining few minutes is to try to look at how what they did to reduce this, to get this down, so that we can learn from that. Just see the graph, right? It's almost taken to nothing. And this is essentially because of a lot of cooperation that has taken place in the Kamla area. You have countries working together. South Africa, Australia were big on this. In fact, in one incident, they chased one boat for up to 30 days in the Southern Ocean to try to capture the boat, and they did. And so this had a huge impact. And essentially, the key thing is about inter-organizational cooperation and country-level cooperation. So one country sees a boat and suspects that it is fishing illegally and it's moving towards another country, you report to the authorities. And they have Kamla, which is a research body that has information, they check with them to confirm. And you have a network of action. You have NGOs playing a part, and it's the combination of a lot of action that led to this success. And I think we need a lot of that in Africa, because many of the countries by themselves are just too small on their own to be able to do this. So you need regional collaboration, whether it is in the Benguela, Angola, South Africa, Namibia, or on this coast or in West Africa, countries have to come together to pool resources together in order to try to deal with this issue. So this was a survey in the paper I just cited, where we took a number of variables and we asked 50 organizations that are actively working to take down IUU fishing, and we asked them, what are the key things that help in terms of achieving this goal? And you see up there, the first one is political will. Everybody talks about political will. It is important. A government has to say, we need to take this down, and that starts the whole action. So that was on top. Most of these 50 organizations said that was very important. Government agency collaboration. You have to collaborate with the Coast Guard, with the police, with the courts. Very important. In South Africa, a few years ago, they got so frustrated because you go out and you catch somebody fishing illegally, you bring him, mostly is him, or almost always him, you bring him to court, and then the judges will say, but what has the man done? He just caught fish, go home, right? So you have to have collaboration all through the system, and so on and so forth. So these are variables in our data that showed what you need to do if you want to take down illegal fishing. So that's it, and so on and so forth. So essentially, that is, I think we are at the end of my stuff. This is really the last thing I wanted to show you. And I keep coming back to the losses to Africa. We're talking $1 billion. But if you look at it, it's about 1 million tons of fish that is taken illegally. And to just give you an idea of how important that is, if you convert 1 million tons of fish into the number of mature cows that are being lost in terms of weight, that is about 1 million mature cows that we are losing from the ocean. So you could get 1 million more cows, right, from the ocean. You can call them fish cows, right? So this is serious stuff, and we need to take action to take down illegal fishing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rashid. I think that was an excellent summary of essentially how broad, but also how serious the illegal fishing problem is. And a number of the points that you made about the lack of a consequence for many illegal fishers, and the fact that that can actually corrupt legitimate fishing, and the need for regional cooperation, particularly in areas where individual countries' capacity to deal with the problem may not be so strong, is a really interesting one, and one that I'll bring up later in the discussion. Now, a lot of this, of course, relates not only to domestic policies, but also to international frameworks. And I'm very pleased to have Juan Carlos Vázquez on the panel. Juan Carlos works, as I was saying before, for CITES, which is, of course, the premier international legally binding framework to address trade in endangered species in particular. So this is the second of our sort of global scope presentations. Juan Carlos, I'm very pleased to have you here. The floor is yours, and here's your clicker as well.
I would like to thank you for the invitation, but also to congratulate you for organizing this conversation. It's a long overdue, and since we discussed before the Doha round in 2001, trying to bring together the trade community and the environmental community, because we have trade experts and environmental experts, but we don't have experts that know to cross the lines. This type of forum is really, really a long overdue. Congratulations for organizing. I prepare a presentation, which I don't see on the screen. So I need, that's the one, okay. So let me first talk briefly about CITES, the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. This is a hybrid animal. It's a mix of trade law, customs law, and environmental law. The GATT was involved in the drafting, the World Customs Council at the time, IUCN, and the UN, and the recently created UNEP that is based here in Nairobi, were involved in the drafting of this treaty. That is quite a powerful tool because it combines trade, environment, and development. And that was recognized at the Rio+20 meeting in a paragraph that recognized that CITES stands at the intersection between trade, the environment and development, and this intersection is what I think we are talking about here in this meeting. CITES promotes conservation and sustainable use of wild fauna and flora. And if I can say, CITES doesn't promote trade, doesn't encourage trade, but if trade happens in the species that we list, it has to follow the rules. In other words, I would say that trade for us is not positive, trade is not negative, trade is not neutral. Trade happens. And if it happens, we need to make sure that trade is legal, sustainable, and traceable. And for that, we need to work together on ensuring this, because it's not an easy task. So far, we have 181 parties, so it's a global treaty. We protect 35,000 species of fauna and flora, timber, marine species, great mammals like elephants, apes, tigers, and also small and less charismatic animals like frogs and crocodiles, snakes, things that people are scared about and more willing to exploit without a lot of media attention. 3% of these species are in Appendix 1. That means that they are in danger and cannot be traded. They get a lot of attention in the media because you have all the great apes, the marine turtles, some elephant populations, rhinos there. And 97% of the species can be traded legally, sustainably, and in a traceable manner. When we talk about legal trade, we need to associate this with illegal trade as well, because if we don't enforce the rules, the law-abiding traders get unfair competition from these free riders that don't respect the rules, and that also get to position at probably the cheapest value in the markets the same species. So we are losing money, and this is affecting not only the economies of the countries, but also the livelihoods of the local poor in many countries rich in biodiversity. Just to set the scene and give some numbers, UNODC estimates the trade in the value of illegal wildlife trafficking annually between 10 and 20 billion. This is the third, fourth illegal trafficking after drugs, counterfeited goods, human trafficking. If you combine this with timber and fisheries, illegal fishing, the figures increase exponentially. We are talking about 30 to 100 billion per year if we include illegal logging and illegal fishing. The scale of this trade has changed dramatically with the globalization and the new means of transport, the digital era, the way we do business. The global trade is in the rise, legal and illegal trade. So we require new responses also to deal with this new challenge. And it may come as not surprise for you that CITES has long been closely connected to WTO and with some free trade agreements to tackle this matter. Just to give you some examples of the things that you are more familiar with, in 3 years, Africa lost 100,000 elephants that were poached. Last year in South Africa, the poachers killed 1,215 rhinos, and there is a new species, less known, pangolins, that is becoming the new concern of the international community, because this is heavily poached and illegally traded in international markets. These are photos of things that are happening now in the Amazonian countries. This is how the traffickers, and let me tell you an anecdote there. When I went there, this is the border between Peru and Brazil, and you have drug trafficking, timber traffickers, everything is going there, and they arrested a drug trafficker. And he was very offended by that, because he said, "Please, I'm a drug trafficker. I'm not a timber trafficker. You are insulting me." Because this is the worst type of traffickers in the region. And if I can show you some examples, they are really deep in the forest, so these are 12, 15 days of boat to get there. So they need to exploit the timber. They misuse a lot of timber, because in order to take the timber out of the forest to the rivers, they need to cut smaller trunks. And that's a lot of waste of timber, when we show these photos to these indigenous peoples that are the Ashanikas, these are isolated indigenous populations in the Amazonian, they were crying to see how they are wasting the timber. And they have also conflict because some of these protected areas are invaded by these groups that are armed groups, trafficking in arms. They are also poaching because they need to eat, and they are forcing people to work because there are not machines, so the slaves that they have there, forced labor is happening. They need to carry these trunks on their dock and their backs. So this is the situation of these people living in the Amazonia and trying to extract this timber for the international markets. We also have trade going through the mailing system. We have trade going through the airport every day. So these are turtles that are very in danger from Madagascar. Yokeleone radiata for the pet market, and we have trade that combines drug trafficking with a boa constrictor. So we detected the authorities in Miami treatment of boas that had cocaine, 39 kilos of cocaine inside the boas. So this is impacting regional security, the rule of law, the livelihoods of the local people, ecotourism, ecosystems. Some parks here in Africa, and I think we are going to hear more interesting stories from our colleagues here from the region, are being affected because our conflicts are going on, and some areas are not accessible anymore for tourism, which represent an important sector in the economy of countries like Kenya or South Africa. So it's a question of scale as well. We are 7.2 billion people consuming biodiversity every day. Medicines, clothes, furniture, everything. You all have biodiversity in your pockets or in your shoes or bags or what. So we are consuming biodiversity without being aware that we are consuming biodiversity. Sometimes because the traders, the finished products, they don't like to make this connection. So if I can, we are in a kind of secret meeting here. If we can say Gucci bags, for instance, to say this comes from a python or from a crocodile, they are not making this connection that we would like to see as a positive connection, because sustainable use will help local communities reduce poverty, use sustainably the species, and be good for the consumers as well. So we're still trying to find a way to communicate on this, because that's the trickiest part for these brands that are scared about the reputation of all these NGOs campaign. This semester has been a great semester of optimism for the multilateralism and the work of the international community. We have adopted a UN resolution on tackling illicit trafficking of wildlife in July. We adopted the SDGs in September. The climate change agreement was adopted last week, and perhaps more is to come here in Nairobi this week, these 2 weeks. So we are seeing an evolution in the political international framework and willingness of the big actors. So we are seeing, for instance, Mr. President Obama and President Xi of China sitting together to discuss about wildlife issues. And when they sit together to discuss the issue, the whole political will of the countries change radically. And we are also seeing, for instance, other type of multilateral agreements like the Trans-Pacific Agreement, including a whole chapter on CITES implementation and wild fauna and flora in the new agreement that includes 12 countries, and I think others are now willing to join as well. And this is a big difference for us. I was the witness of the implementation of the environmental chapter agreement of the US-Peruvian trade promotion agreement. And that changed the whole dynamic, because normally I go and see the CITES authorities in the ministries of environment or ministries of agriculture. For that agreement, it was a condition that the Peru should comply with CITES legislation, and they should be in category one, which is a system we use to categorize the countries. And I was received by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. The minister itself asking, what are you asking for? Because we need to implement that in order to get this agreement signed. So this was the first country I saw that was able to reform the criminal code in 6 months to include as an offense, serious crime, the illegal trade in fisheries, wild fauna and flora, including timber, and in genetic resources, thanks to this trade negotiation. So I think that combining trade and natural resources negotiation is the way forward, and perhaps should be also considered the other way around. So that as we combine environmental issues with trade issues, the trade negotiators should be able also to combine trade issues with climate change, with natural resources, because it's becoming really difficult to discuss all these issues in an isolated manner and in clinical isolation, as used to say the lawyer Marcel from WTO. So next year is also looking promising. We have a CITES standing committee in January to discuss trade-related matters regarding timber, for instance. We have a big issue with illegal timber, rosewood from Madagascar going through Zanzibar to the Asian markets. We are recommending actions there, trade measures, including quota, trade suspensions, etc. And this will be discussed in Geneva in January, and we'll have a first, and after that we have the World Wildlife Day in March. The 3rd of March is the World Wildlife Day, and the theme is the future of wildlife is in our hands. So we invite all of you to join this campaign, and we end with the conference of the parties to CITES that will be in South Africa in Johannesburg in September, October. That will be one of the big meetings of next year, together with the IUCN Congress in Hawaii, just weeks before in September. And we have also the UNEA General Assembly here in Nairobi, I think, in May. So we have opportunities to combine these two big bodies of international work that are not talking enough together. And I see here that we still having some work to do to convince them of the importance of dealing with these issues in a more cooperative manner. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Juan Carlos. I mean, I think that was an excellent survey, really, of the various connections between wildlife trade and what the trade system can do and what the trade system is already doing to try and address some of these problems. Now, both you and Rashid have brought up this question of livelihoods, right? It's essential in addressing the issue to be able to make wildlife trade, where it makes sense, actually a sustainable livelihood option. And I was really interested to see in the 2030 agenda that when the targets speak about addressing poaching and illegal trade of wildlife products, they also link it very explicitly to making sure that there are alternative sustainable livelihood options available. So I think that's an excellent segue into Philip's few comments, because I think it's easy to say and it's easy to put into an international declaration, but obviously it's much more difficult to do. So Philip, can you talk to us a little bit about it, specifically in the African context, on the basis of your experience, not only about sort of wildlife conservation and trade and illegal trade, but what's the link to sustainable livelihoods, both positive and negative? Thanks.
Thank you very much. I think I do not have a slide presentation, but we can leave that one there. What Carlos has told us about is perhaps just a third of the trade that occurs in wildlife. If you look at trade in ivory, for example, the ivory that goes to countries such as China and such as Japan is only about 30%. 70% of that, of the rest of the ivory consumed in those countries is illegal. And I just want to say that, you know, illegal trade itself, as somebody said, illegal trade is bad for good trade, for legal trade. In the communities that we work with, or in the areas where we work with wildlife, trying to promote wildlife on the development agenda for Africa, we find that it is a struggle, and that wildlife often has to make the case for livelihood. But we do believe, and I hope everyone here does believe with me, that wildlife has a place on the development agenda for Africa and for livelihoods of local people and livelihoods and local economies and even national economies. Now, direct benefits from wildlife, of course, can come from finance, from financial gains. It can come from generating revenues, say, from communities working with the safari operators, for example, with projects that are common in this region. We have natural benefits, like Carlos has mentioned. We have ecosystem goods. We have those species, or from ecological services. There are services which are related to wildlife that we don't often think about as a wildlife benefit, such as pollination, such as seed dispersal. There are certain plants that we know of in the tropics where the seeds have to pass through the guts of, say, elephants for those to germinate. Those, if you look at the whole connection to livelihoods of the people who live in those areas, it's the elephants supporting that dispersal of that, or the germination of that particular plant. That plant then supports other species, and that plant is commercial in certain ways. So when illegal trade gets into play, it affects the whole chain. There are benefits that accrue from economic benefits, that accrue from stimulating markets, education, the building of schools, health facilities, and social amenities. And often, wildlife, where it has succeeded, brings in infrastructure, builds in geographical benefits, other benefits like that. Now, illegal trade, as I said, is bad for livelihoods, for sustainable livelihoods, because it introduces, for example, poaching has an impact on the very species which form the basis for good trade, say for tourism, for local communities, or even for national parks. I will just brainstorm with you some of the impacts to sustainable livelihoods that illegal wildlife trade brings in our experience. With the current poaching crisis that we are in, we have experienced in some cases, like recently I was in South Africa and was very lucky to visit with the manager of Sabisan's private reserve next to Kruger. They opened their fence with Kruger so that they could allow those 9,000 rhinos there and many more species to proliferate and also to have benefits come from conservation and share them with the park. Because of the increase in poaching in that area, the manager shared with me some statistics. His budget for protecting rhinos and for protecting the reserve has gone up 3 times. That therefore means that the very premise for which many of us have written in proposals and gotten funded, that you know, the parks and the protected areas have to share benefits with those communities adjacent to them. David told me, there is no way I'm sharing, because he has nothing to share. The only way Kruger is working now and protecting the wildlife there is through some grants. And that is something that we is a very direct impact of illegal activities, such as poaching and trafficking. The costs go up due to hiring more men and buying more equipment. As poaching has become sophisticated, the cost of fighting poaching and trafficking has gone up tremendously. And that those resources are not available to be shared. The Of course, some people might argue, well, you can always get those people and they'll pay fines. We have already been told that even those fines that they pay are very, very minuscule. So really, you wouldn't count on those income. Ecological impacts of poaching that we have are very indiscriminate. So we have families of elephants being killed. We have a whole entire families, which means the impact is not just now. It is into the future.
Reductions of species numbers and population numbers, such as we have this figure, which is often quoted now, that the forest elephant has declined by about 60% in the last about two decades. That means that for those communities, if they were thinking about tourism as a base, based on the availability of the elephants they had there, that is no longer an issue for them, because nobody is going to come there. Of course, insecurity is a big problem. Here in Kenya, the whole of northern Kenya would be really nice for improving livelihoods through tourism. But who wants to go into an area that is insecure? So poaching, poachers having enjoined, and traffickers having enjoined themselves with other illegal activities, such as Al-Shabaab and others, make those areas not benefit from wildlife. I have already mentioned the loss of ecosystem services, and those are which we do not often understand. We, for example, do not understand what is happening. As Carlos has told us, that there are about 35,000 species that are CITES listed, but there are many more which are not. And so by illegal activities, we do not know even some of what we are losing. Other impacts that we have seen recently, and which we'll be celebrating the Conservation Heroes at KWS, was it on Wednesday? It will be on tomorrow. Loss of lives. About 500 people have died at the border of Kruger and Mozambique in the last about 10 years due to direct, what law enforcement people like to call, contact. That means that those families have lost individuals, but because of trafficking and the cost of rhino horn has gone up so much and poaching is so lucrative, people still go. So the number increases of the people who are being lost. But also we are losing rangers and we are losing community scouts. Insecurity also has seen in some areas opportunities being lost because people who wanted to start conservancies or who wanted to start rhinos or conservancies for endangered species, such as here in Kenya, have had to give away. So in just to give you specific examples, Mugi Ranch, north of here, and the Osirian, west of here, had rhinos on their land, which they were going to include communities' benefits into them. They had to return those rhinos to Kenya Wildlife Service because it is too expensive. It is too expensive to any tourism operation, and so they have had to return those. That opportunity is lost for any incomes that would have come with that. Parallel economies develop. And those parallel economies, the problem is they compete with the legal economy. So they offer services, they don't pay taxes, and it's unfair competition to legal businesses. Corruption is big. Illegal wildlife trade brings corruption. If you read the Nation newspaper today, you will see an example of this, where a truck has been apprehended by Kenya Wildlife Service transporting sandalwood. That sandalwood is from Baringo, in a very poor community, from a poor community, which I'm sure they are not going to get any of that 5.2 million shillings. And who was transporting that sandalwood? A police truck. As I have said, there is dilution of value of the legal product. There is perpetuating connections with other illegal activities. Just to conclude, I want to say that I believe it is very hard to talk about sustainable livelihoods
while we still have illegal trade in wildlife, especially at the levels at which we are at the moment. We have to deal with the illegal poaching, we have to curb trafficking, and then we can start talking about wildlife being on the table of sustainable livelihoods in Africa. Thank you.
Philip, that was fascinating. Thank you very much. I think you've covered a lot of ground there.
You end up with illegal trade functioning and undermining the sustainable trade, which of course in the short term is exceptionally damaging to the immediate livelihoods of the people wanting to benefit from the natural resource, but also that in the longer term, the undermining of governance in these areas has an impact on broadly on what the economic prospects are, and in particular on the possibilities for tourism. And I think from a trade policy perspective, it's to remember that we're talking
not only about trade in wildlife products as goods, but we're also talking about trade in services. I mean, tourism, foreign tourists come into a country, this is essentially trade in a service, and an exceptionally valuable one at that. But both of these points, I think, lead us very logically to the question of governance. What is the link between illegal, particularly illegal wildlife trade, and the various ways in which that can undermine governance efforts? And for that, I'm very pleased to have Mohammed Awer on the panel. Mohammed, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Alice, for organizing this. And thank you to ICSDD, Earth and Mind, and Africa Wildlife Foundation for organizing this session. just before I came here, I stopped over at the Jamia Mosque for midday prayers. And I had my back and somebody asked me, you're going to the World Trade Organization meeting? Knowing that I work for WWF. For him, he didn't understand the connections. So my first thing actually would be to struggle to show, well, just to remind people, because we're already talking to those who are converted in this room, why we're here together and what has environment or in general beyond illegal trade to do with the conference of World Trade Organization. And as Philip said rightly, we all recognize that illegal trade not only undermines, illegal trade undermines illegal trade. All of us understand that. I mean, we know that. And two, generally, there is now clear connection, or which is demonstrated, between development and environment. The days where we used to see conflict between the two, and we will ask the question, are we talking about integrated conservation development, starting with conservation for development or development for conservation, is gone. All of us understand the connections. Just to demonstrate a specific case very close here, in 2009, we had what we consider the severest drought in Kenya in 80 years. And one of the groups that was affected was the large growers, flora growers in Naivasha. The operation cost actually went so much that in that year, I think all of them reported losses. And these were massive losses because you are talking about groups like Osirian that export 600 million stems every year. And at, say, a price of €1, you are talking about 600 million euros. And out of that, they actually realized the connection between their businesses and availability of water. And out of that, they have come to develop a number of things, including a water allocation plan, which is binding, developed and binding for all users in Naivasha. And number two, they have gone beyond that and participated in an international initiative called the Floriculture Sustainability Initiative, which is supported by the Dutch, the Dutch Sustainable Trade Initiative. Which brings all people in the value chain. So I'm just trying to demonstrate that we are past that time when you question what is the connection between development or trade in this case and environment. So that is number one. And number two is what we want to talk about in terms of policy coherence and collaboration for good governance. We all recognize the scale and the mechanics of the business of illegal trade is such that no country can win it on its own. If I use my country, Kenya, which I know very well, we know that Kenya is a conduit for illegal timber trade from Southern Africa and from Central Africa. We are not only major consumers, but we are also conduits for these products. Number two, the number of seaports and airports in East Coast of Africa also major exits for commodity, I mean illegal products coming from as far as Central Africa. So the connections are there, and this is really an opportunity to bring these connections and discuss them at a higher level so that we have this coherence at the different levels and across borders. So for me, those are the two issues which will really make us understand the connections and why people, all of us here from different organization conservation backgrounds in this discussion. And following from that, you now all recognize that even the Sustainable Development Goals, which have just been concluded in September, have very clear targets on environment and even illegal trade. Specifically, target number 15.7 is about tackling the problem of poaching and trafficking of protected species. The Addis Ababa Action Agenda is also very clear in terms of its targets, not only on illegal wildlife trade, but also IEU and illegal logging. So all these issues just show how the connections are established more and more. In terms of what I want to look is two things. Number one is, it is one, but I will split them into two. One is illegal logging of timber, and the second one is illegal wildlife or fauna trade. It is very interesting that actually these now attracts a lot of international attention, including Chatham House that has recently done a study on illegal trade in timber. And the report shows that more than 80 million cubic meters of timber was illegally produced in the year 2013. This is actually equivalent to one third of all timber that is produced. And resulting from this, one thing that many people don't recognize is that illegal timber trade makes significant contributions to greenhouse gases. It is estimated by this study that about 190 million tons of carbon dioxide is released to the atmosphere, which is more than the contribution by Norway, Denmark, and Sweden combined. And in terms of very quick values globally, I don't want to repeat what Johan has given in terms of numbers. It is in excess of timber alone is about $10 billion, which is not a small amount of money. What is not actually captured is that, in fact, about another $5 billion is lost annually by governments due to evaded taxes, fees, and other income that are related to legal forestry. Coming close to Tanzania, there is a recent study that was done by the government and TRAFFIC, which you know is an organization that is supported by WWF and IUCN. And this report, I will quote it because the ministry was involved, shows that Tanzania lost $58 million to illegal trade in timber in that single year. This is equivalent to actually 2 years' budget of the Ministry of Natural Resources and Tourism in Tanzania. And if it was put into development, that will have supported 1,900 primary schools or bought 11 million mosquito nets for people in mosquito-infested areas. So I will leave the login numbers on that because of time. If we come to illegal trade in the big species, here in Kenya, in the last 3 years, we have lost on average about 55 rhinos, black and white combined, in the last three years. As Johan said, South Africa is a very sad situation. In just 1 year, they lost about 1,200 rhinos. So this is really a problem we are dealing with it. And without spending more time on this, I just want to say in sum, the numbers we have, indicative numbers show that in Africa we lost about 30,000 elephants in every year the last 3 years. On a good note, I want to say that the numbers actually are coming down. Positive note, the numbers are coming down. In Kenya, last year was the lowest number that we witnessed in the last almost 4 years. A very good indicator of this is the fact that there are now more inceptions in Africa than in Asia. In terms of governance, in his inaugural speech, the president of Kenya committed himself to fight illegal trade in wildlife. And following from that, the parliament in Kenya enacted what we consider one of the most progressive legislation in wildlife, with very severe penalties for those who participate in this trade. Tanzania has formed a ministerial task force to deal with this. And 3 months ago, they actually arrested the kingpin of illegal trade in ivory and rhino horn in Tanzania. And that case is in court. In South Africa, they actually gave the severest penalty of, I think it was 35 years to... So, well, this thing is very depressing, but the good thing is that things are happening, and we have people in court, and in fact, the governments are pursuing illegally exported wildlife products. Here at home in Kenya, we know this case that is still in court, where people have actually been even refused bail because it's considered a national security issue now. So the level of intervention has gone up. We believe that it is not just about government that should be involved in this major issue. We recognize and we really support there should be broad-based partnership, bringing together private sector, civil society, government, and communities. And in this regard, a number of civil societies led by WWF organized an international campaign against illegally traded wildlife in 2013. We are very happy with the outcome of that, that countries like China and Thailand have made serious concessions. Yuan maybe will come to that during the discussion, because some of those declarations were made in Doha CITES meeting. In terms of private sector, we see more involvement of private sector, whether it is through the transport sector or mainly transport sector, couriers and this, and even private sector supported initiatives in this. Communities have major role to play. Media has also a major role to play to sensitize this. And actually, going to private sector, technology companies have a big role to play, because we know that with the advent of mobile technology in many places, poachers have become very sophisticated. And they have also established very unholy alliances with the people in protected areas. So it has become, technology has actually facilitated and make the work of protected area managers very difficult. Because by the time, the coordination is much more organized than it was 10 years ago. That these people will move this thing and there will be somebody waiting to pick on the roadside, and before you know, this thing has moved miles.
What really comes to mind when you talk about Kenya to many people, at least, in the wildlife, because they saw it on National Geographic, even those who have not traveled here. Others would remember when they last came and they want to come again, but then they realize they are already here, so this is good. So wildlife forms a very big part, a very big percentage of the raw material that is tourism, and tourism is an extremely important area with us. If you look at the way that wildlife is spread from the government perspective and KWS that looks at conservation, we've divided the country into ecoregions, 8 of them, and those different shades then indicate different areas. Starting from the north, where now we have a lake that is under the lake that we can see, Lake Turkana. We are told the water there can last Kenya 70 years without having to borrow any water from the Indian Ocean or from some friends. And the protected areas comprise about 8% of the country, and they're further supplemented now by many areas that have been set aside by the private sector and by communities. So you will now be hearing of conservancies, community conservancies, because they are setting aside areas so that they can have wildlife in terms of meeting their livelihoods, and Philip has talked about that. Kenya Wildlife Service is mandated through the Constitution and also through this new Wildlife Act to manage the wildlife in the country. So whichever area it is, whether it's on private land or community land or the protected areas that are under government, you will find that they are guided by this law, and Kenya decided to use a parastatal to be able to manage this particular wildlife. The framework is now going to be able to include the communities so that they are more participative, the county government so that they have a say, the private sector so that they have a say, and that is depicted by the way that we have constructed the areas that we are now managing the wildlife at this point. In terms of law enforcement, you will find that there is a high demand at the international level of wildlife products. And this puts a lot of pressure where the wildlife is. And what is disheartening is that cartels, very rich and very well connected and very mobile, and people who are very versatile, are the ones who are now getting engaged in this. And that is the reason why now you find this particular demand going up. It's good to develop, it's good to get richer, it's a good idea to have everybody having their livelihood improve. But actually that's what now makes people have discretionary spend, some spare money, and they want to buy something unique, something from Africa, you know, a tinklet from the elephant ivory, and they want the tail of a mongoose, and they want something else. So the demand goes up, and that puts a lot of pressure on this particular area. We are seeing that the poachers, the middlemen, everybody is now adapting very new systems. So they, instead of carrying the raw ivory, they now finish it here, they make it into other products so that it's easier for them to then be able to pass. When they go out, whether they're looking for bushmeat, they now have developed silent methods, and this now makes it very difficult for us to follow through. We find that the routes that they were using, they have become complicated by becoming rudimental. So instead of big trucks that carry, they now use bicycles, or they just walk across. So it makes it even more difficult for us to be able to follow through. And then the methods that they're using and the concealments that they are employing make it even more difficult now to be able to follow through. And sometimes if we do not have adequate collaboration at the international level, it makes it very difficult for us to follow through, because it means then that we are not connected in terms of dealing with the matter. And if you are to look at some of the methods, the passengers just carry their bags, and inside the bags you'll have ivory that is concealed. So they will pretend that they're actually carrying those bags. And I think Jean Carlos was also able to explain that point. Some cargo will come through containers at the ports. And again, you think it's just something else, but it ends up being ivory. Sometimes they will package it with other items to be able to try and shield the approaches. Sometimes they wear the as jewelry, so that you it's much more difficult for you to then follow. In transportation by road, they will use vehicles that are known, they are tinted, and they look tough, and they look very, very high profile. It's difficult even for the police to want to stop those ones. They're not so sure who is in that vehicle. And then we discover that they actually even have concealed points. They have false bottoms, which is where they put their items. Sometimes they post they post the when they are trading, they will post products or even wildlife. So if it comes by post or it comes through courier services, you may take a little while to detect. Sometimes they conceal it, and they say that they are exporting plastic wastes. And again, they package it and label it and put or call it avocado or macadamia nuts. They try as much as possible to conceal. Sometimes they have the finished products and they paint them. They put tints, red, purple, very colorful things. And you think, oh, maybe this is just made of plastic or it's something else. But they go even further. They will look at permits. They will try and forge those permits or steal them or create something or even take signatures, quickly just glance around and quickly put in their memory the way the signature of an official looks, and then the next thing you hear, a signature has been stolen from the individual. So I think in terms of looking at what really is happening right now, excuse me, you'll find that a lot of national and international declarations, particularly pertaining to wildlife, have been put in place in the last 2 to 3 years, or at least in the last couple of years. And this is now helping to be able to work together as the world community. And this will help to be able to put a lot of things to stop, because if we do not work together, we have a big challenge. So fortunately, because of the efforts that are being done, we will have seen the law being very strong, so that people now can be jailed for life. They are fined 20 million Kenya shillings. We have seen the support from the highest political office. The First Lady is the patron of a slogan or a campaign that is called Hands Off Our Elephants. And she actually tweets, if something happens on wildlife, she will tweet and say, I am very disappointed that this wildlife has died. And she takes note of whatever the security agencies would have done. Our president himself is a member of the Giants Club. It's a new movement coming across Africa to look at some of the issues to do with the wildlife conservation. But I'm sure maybe in the discussions, I will be able to put more to light in terms of what is actually being done. But that is the situation. It's a big challenge. And we are hoping that if we strengthen the legal trade, then there will be place for the legal trade to then help us in stopping the illegal trade. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Paul. I mean, I can see a number of themes emerging from this discussion already. You know, there's a lot of discussion about the role of penalties, right? The role of actually making it uneconomic to pursue an illegal operation when you could actually pursue a legal one, right? The role that this parallel illegal economy can play in undermining the potential for legal trade. And if you're interested in legal trade and natural resources, and in particular around making sure that that's sustainable, a small plug, there is another session directly following this one, which we've also organized with EarthMind and Oxford University, talking about voluntary standards for trade and natural resources. But what's interesting also in that in particular is the role of the private sector. What is the role of legal producers and legal traders of these products in trying to maintain their market share? The role of technology companies, for example, in establishing systems that will enable legal trade and enable the differentiation of legal and illegal products. And we were talking, Paul, just before about the role of trade facilitation. It may facilitate a lot of legal trade, but how do you stop it also facilitating illegal trade? I have a number of questions. I'm not going to put them all to the panel right now. We do have some time for further questions, so can I open the floor, please, to questions to any of our panelists about the issues raised? And we have a gentleman in the back, Jaime.
Thank you for these very interesting presentations. And as I was listening to all of them, it reminded me of Paul Collier's Plundered Planet, where you say, if only you have technology, then you get a plundered planet, but if you have technology plus institutions, then you get prosperity. Of course, it's a simplification. When I was listening to all this illegal trade, I was getting the impression that the race towards improved technology is going much faster on the illegal than on the other side, which is to be able to certify that the trade is, or that the harvesting is not illegal. So that's maybe just an observation. But then on the question of fisheries, which I thought was very interesting, because now we're actually working with ECOWAS and UMOA on how to deepen regional integration. And obviously, one thing we've been thinking about and trying to push, not with much success yet, is to say, well, you know, we should do something about fish, which is a common pool resource at the regional level. So my general question here is, what is the, for the panelists, what do you think is the hope for getting more progress towards SDGs or conserving nature through regional agreements? I heard one of you said that the TPP was going in that direction, that some countries were changing their laws just in order to be able to be members. So that's north, you could say that's a north-south agreement. But let's say you're going to have ECOWAS. ECOWAS is south-south. So will you have the will, so to speak, to really get an agreement really enforced? Thank you.
Fantastic, excellent question. What I'm going to do is I'm going to collect a number of different questions, and then I'm going to give our panelists each the opportunity to address them as time allows. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon. I must thank all the presenters. They have really given us fantastic insights into all the topics. I'm a fish person, and I come from the ECOWAS region. I agree with what Professor Rashid presented. And talking of regional organizations, I know we have several in the ECOWAS region, but it takes time to ratify the agreements. Some countries have the resources to do it. A lot of the countries don't have. Like we have the FCWC, you know, and it seems as if it's only two countries out of around the six that's carrying the thing. Then everybody knows that most of the IUU now is being done in the Atlantic Ocean, within the African region, especially the ECOWAS region. Yes, CAMLA group, they could chase for days, 30 days, thunder, because they have the financial resources. We don't have in our region. Now, we try to go into MCS. Cameroon did it. Nigeria, for the past 2 years, we've been trying. Cameroon did it and left. Why? Because of the payment for the real time. The equipment are there. When it comes to the payment for the real time, because this thing did not generate from Africa, the technology is not with us. We have to depend on the technicians from the developed countries to pay. And at the end of the day, they let us down. So that, again, has encouraged IUU fishing. Because if we cannot patrol our waters, then it's a free-for-all. And Joanne cites, well, you've been doing quite a lot of things, and I've had opportunity to be involved with the FAO. However, what I notice is that IUCN does its research within maybe the Indian Ocean, Pacific, and another group in the Americas, but nobody is doing much in the Atlantic Ocean. I think you should take that into consideration. Two, in the ECOWAS region, there's a problem with CITES. Fisheries is not part of wildlife in most of our ministries. And you have CITES makes the Ministry of Environment and Forestry in a place like Nigeria to be in CITES issue. But this affects the fisheries arm. They don't have the expertise. I know I brought it up at several forums, and they did say we should write that we want fisheries to be in charge of the fisheries aspect of CITES. but they should also look at it holistically in countries, because it might be escalating IUU problems and poaching where the CITES authorities in a country is not strong enough for that particular project. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much indeed. I think we have two really interesting questions there. I mean, the first is specifically relevant to this trade policy environment is the question of what kind of progress is there, or what prospect of progress is there for conservation, specifically of wildlife, but also perhaps of broader natural resources in the context of trade agreements, and in particular of regional trade agreements. And the second one, I think, is this question of domestic policy coherence. Right? Do we find that there are different ministries addressing different parts of natural resources, and a different ministry, again, addressing trade policy? What's the prospect for improved policy coherence at a domestic level? And a final plug, we do have another session looking specifically at the international level of policy coherence later this afternoon. But with those two questions, perhaps, I'll take room for one if it's really quick, and then I'll come back to the panel. Go ahead.
Thank you, Ms. Tipping, and thanks to the panel for an interesting discussion this afternoon. We heard a lot about loss of... by the way, my name's Eric from the Embassy of Sweden here in Nairobi. We heard a lot about the loss of biodiversity, the loss of government revenue, and you know all these reasons why illegal wildlife trade is bad, and we all agree with that. But in terms of solutions, Mr. Gatito pointed to some of them regarding enforcement, but obviously understanding that many of these trade routes are illicit and illegal, but I haven't heard anyone mention the role of customs and intelligence training with customs. We saw a lot of Paul's pictures. There seem to be some of the trade routes actually going through through customs perhaps, and or official roads and so forth. So if perhaps Paul and also Mr. Vasquez, given that there's 180 some signatories to the CITES convention on the sort of appetite and demand for this type of training, and what you do to support that. Thank you.
Fantastic, thank you. An excellent third question. I'll come back to the panel now, perhaps, and invite you to answer any one of those three questions, and specifically Paul and Juan Carlos, this last third question about customs. Mohammed, maybe I'll start with you and come across.
Thank you very much for those interesting questions. On technology, actually, it cuts both parts. I'm sorry, I just talked about the negative part. But we're also using the technology positively in places like Mara and like Nakuru National Park, in a partnership with Google and KWS, where we have installed DNA calibrated thermal cameras that will detect anything that is not wildlife as soon as you get into the point, and will be detected at the right points. And that has really helped with those two protected areas. So technology, both ways. Prosecution, customs, I will leave customs for CTS, but in terms of prosecution, judiciary, in fact, tomorrow I'm going to attend a meeting organized by the Judiciary Training Institute in Kenya that we support. And the idea is to prepare judges and prosecutors, judges and everybody in the prosecution chain for prosecuting and judging in wildlife-related crimes. So in terms of IUU, the problem we have is just investment, that African countries are not investing sufficiently in MCS, monitoring, surveillance, and control. For those, there are too many acronyms. So we just need to we get the right investment, we get the right results. Thank you.
Yeah. The first question on the ECOWAS and West Africa. Your observation about technology, the speed of technology versus institutions, I think is right on. I mean, I remember in a discussion sometime this year where I made the comment that if the human institutions and the way we deal with each other were developing as fast as technology, will have no problem in the world today, really. So I think that is what you are alluding to, and I agree with that. So we need to speed up institutional development and human relations, the way we deal with each other. Yeah. Now, on ECOWAS, This is a good question, and I really care about it. I mean, the Gulf of Guinea is one area that I'm particularly interested in for good reasons. I mean, I'm from that part of the world. And about 3 years ago, me and my colleague from UBC, we actually organized a workshop for high-level government people from the 16 countries fishing in the Gulf of Guinea, just to make clear to them that the biology of the system actually warrants that they work cooperatively. Because if you are Togo or Ivory Coast or Ghana, the water is just, your own EEZ is not independent of the other EEZs, so you need to work together. So we had an ecological course and an economic course. We made them to build models, and I think that is one way to start getting people to understand the connections and therefore the importance of collaboration. So knowledge and information is important. Now, this goes to the second question, where the resources, my sister out there talked about resources, the lack of resources, which is a big thing. And that is one reason why I advocate the collaboration between countries. And this is not easy, because the countries are at different levels. You have the big ones, Nigeria, you have Togo, which is just 30 miles from end to end on one point. So it is not easy, but I think that is really one way to start dealing with the resource problem, because then you can pool resources together. And technology can help. The cost of technology is really dropping. I hope it continues dropping. That might be one way to reduce the cost. And to finalize on this, just one more point. I mean, we see the ocean. My group, our group in Vancouver, we always argue that there is one global ocean. It is a system that is connected. So if Canadians are managing their ocean, part of the ocean well, and West Africans are not, the whole system will be messed up. So there is an argument for the larger world to contribute to help reduce IUU fishing, not only in the Gulf of Guinea, but in developing parts of the world, so we have a good ocean.
Fantastic. Thanks very much. Juan Carlos, a few points.
Thank you very much. I will try to respond to the first and third question in the same response by saying that probably traceability is the key for many of these problems in CITES, as we see that to be able to trace from the tree to the furniture at the end. And we're working on technology, so we need to work on single windows, electronic permits, information systems, all should be integrated. This trade is not different from the other trade, so we need to integrate this trade into the global trade of the national economies. And we are working very closely with the World Customs Organization and with other platforms. The World Trade Facilitation Agreement may be a tool for that, because the solution will be sustainability, technologies for sustainability. Technologies are a means, are not the end. So if you don't have the people and the institutions, you have a prosthesis, you have just the gadget, but you don't have the solution. So the solution will be us, the people and the institutions. But talking about South-South or trade agreements, it depends of the context, I would say, of the regions. If you have a recent or more far colonialist history past, it's more easy or more difficult to integrate. But we have the Amazonian countries, for instance. They have the eight countries their own agreement, and they are trying to cooperate. I was thinking that this ECOWAS, COMIFACT in the region are working together. We need to work more to invest in these regional solutions, the donors, the cooperation community, to invest more into these institutions to strengthen the regional aspects and cooperation to also ensure coherence, because it doesn't make sense when you prohibit tough laws in Kenya, no laws in Tanzania, so the mafias will move to the next country. So we need to work regionally. And on fisheries, CITES is starting to work on marine resources, mainly with sharks now. We are working closely with the FAO. This is a policy has to be decided at the national level. We have many countries where the fisheries are managed in CITES by the fisheries ministries, Chile, Peru, or big fishing nations, they have CITES authorities for fisheries are in the fisheries departments. So this is possible in any country. And we will be happy to see how we support regions in the Atlantic phase of Africa to develop capacity. Thank you.
Fantastic. Paul, Philip, a couple of quick 1 minute responses if you can, thanks.
Yes, thank you. In terms of wildlife, pertaining to the first question about regional agreements and the question of illegal wildlife trade and how it affects sustainable livelihoods. It's very important to note that the illegal wildlife trade does not know boundaries. And if you look at movements of key species that are traded today, it's very small amounts that are traded or moved from the same country of origin to international destinations. The movements are very convoluted and very cleverly arranged. So, for example, you have countries like Nigeria and Togo that are major trafficking transit countries, but they don't have many in terms of, say, ivory. So when you look at livelihoods, you've got to ask how that trade is affecting the livelihoods you wanted to improve, say, in a local area in Kenya, how that is being affected by what is happening in Sudan, or what is happening in Angola, or what is happening in Bangkok. We have an effort that we are trying to facilitate the wildlife enforcement networks. So, for example, we have the Horn of Africa Wildlife Enforcement Network. Unfortunately, the process has been slow, but that is how you would curb the illegal movement, particularly the trafficking. And understanding the whole chain is also very important, because you can deal with poaching, like what Paul has explained to us, what Kenya has done. But the illegal wildlife trade is like an amoeba. It goes wherever, you know, there is more food or there is more stimulus. So we do expect that even those populations that look safe now, poaching will come. You know that poaching has recently increased on rhinos in Namibia, a country that for a long time was safe from rhino poaching. So I would say trade can enhance livelihoods, but also we need to really look at this problem beyond a locality and have serious collaboration and serious agreements that are well funded in order to curb this menace.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. Paul, the last word to you.
Yeah. Now, the use of technology. We use trap cameras in some of the parks, and we've actually been able to follow through and make arrests because of people who are completely unaware, and they were playing it out in front of the cameras, and be able to download this information and be able to nab them. In some of the parks, they actually discovered the cameras and they destroyed them. So this is the downside. So it's something that we have seen that we use transmitters in rhinos so that we are able to monitor. We can pick them up with our transmitter readers. So that's another area that we are using, as well as with elephants, so that we can be able to track the various families in those particular areas. And we've recently launched a wildlife forensic lab, which has been very, very helpful. It serves both for the science, for monitoring, but also for prosecution. And when we began, we would get people with bushmeat and they would tell us, no, this is my goat. You know, I've been fattening it for Christmas, so this is the goat that I have slaughtered. And we've been able now to use that forensic lab to actually prove that there's a difference between wildlife and domestic livestock. We have also just concluded an inventory of all the stocks of ivory and all the stocks of rhino horn in the country. And alongside doing the inventory, we also took information for profiling the specific pieces of ivory and rhino, so that you can now be able to follow through that DNA and be able to associate a specific piece of ivory with the source or the particular area for this country. So we are hoping that we can be able to improve on that area and use it for checking what exactly is happening. In terms of progress and whether wildlife has hope, I think in the last 3 years, there's been a lot of activity, starting with the London conference, where Kenya was very strongly represented, and where we began to see the political figures of the world committing to dealing with illegal trade. And it transmitted, or it eventually now led to the meeting last year of UNEA, again, the first time that it was happening, where we had the full assembly of the United Nations, and in it, the question of discussing illegal ivory was brought forward. We had a session like this, a side event, that we were able to participate and put the case forward. And as I mentioned, the political top guns in the country are very, very personally involved, so it makes it much easier for us to push this agenda, and we're able to follow through. In terms of working together about the customs and the other units, there's a lot of effort again in that period to make sure we have joint training, we have collaboration, we have joint activities. So the customs, the airports, the ports, and we are working together. If you go to the major airports around the country, you'll find that our canine unit is there, and they work with the customs, and they're able to now pick any luggage that, as we pointed out here, that also happens at the ports. And we are working together with the immigration, the customs, the police, ourselves. And the country has elevated the issue of dealing with wildlife crime to actually become a national item. So it's not left to KWS and say, you guys just look after your elephants. It becomes now something that the government has placed on the hands of all security agents. So if it happens in a certain area, not only will KWS officials now be held to account, but there will also be the local administration, the police in that area. So the local security committee is held to account, and that has made a very big difference, including Kenya Wildlife Service in the National Security Advisory Council of the country.
And
so
Paul,
that again, they can get...
That speaks to a really high level of policy coherence here. And I think I would love to let you keep going. Okay. I'm afraid we actually have to vacate the room for the next session. Otherwise, I would let you keep going, I promise. Thank you all very, very much for coming. It's been fantastic to have you here. Please fill out the feedback survey that you've seen on your chairs. We do aim to make each one of our events better than the previous one, so please fill it out and help us do that. And thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.